Thank you for joining us here today. I'm Fabiana Bacchini, Executive Director of the Canadian Premature Babies Foundation. CPBF is a charitable organization, and our mission is to support and educate Canadian families of premature babies. This Facebook Live series is one of the many initiatives we have to bring information for NICU families and healthcare professionals. Here every Friday, we talk with experts, researchers, and parents who share with us their experience and knowledge. Also, in our website, canadianpremies.org, parents will find all kinds of resources and support. And last week, we launched our new video series called Welcome to the NICU in collaboration with the Family Integrated Care Committee. And here is a short teaser for you to see what is available.
The NICU can feel very overwhelming and intimidating. But since you are the most important person in your baby's life, it's essential to take an active role in your baby's care. So together, let's get started navigating the many ways you can care for your baby in the NICU.
I really want to thank our presenting sponsor, Medela, who helped us to create this video series. And all four videos are already on our website, which is canadianpremies.org. And right here today, we're going to talk about an international research project, PREM-STEM, which aims to see if stem cells can be used to regenerate the brain damage caused by preterm birth. This five-year project will develop clinical trials ready research program to treat brain injury in premature born infants. Disturbances in brain growth can result in cerebral palsy, severely impair cognitive functions, and other disorders such as ADHD and autism. Stem cells have a huge potential to decrease some of those long-term consequences. And I have here with me, joining live from the Netherlands, Professor Dr. Luke Zimmerman, who is the Senior Medical Director at EFCNI, the European Foundation for the Care of the Newborn Infant in Germany, and Professor of Pediatrics and Neonatology at Maastricht University in the Netherlands. He's also the Program Leader of Reproductive and Perinatal Medicine in the Research Institute GROW. His ambition is to implement the European Standards of Care for the Newborn Health European-wide to improve the situation of mothers and newborn infants and ensure more equal care in Europe. He's involved in several international research projects representing FCNI, such as the PREM-STEM project. Dr. Zimmerman, thank you so much for joining us here today. What a pleasure to have you sharing this very exciting project.
Thank you very much, Fabiana. Thank you for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to present our project. I'm really delighted to talk about it. So, and thank you all for listening. And
thank you. Dr. Zimmerman, you can share your presentation. And once you're done, people who are watching us, feel free to send the questions and your comments on the box below that we can address with Dr. Zimmer at the end of his presentation.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Fabiana introduced me, so I'm going to go to the first slide, and I will talk to you about the PREM-STEM project. It's a project sponsored by the Horizon 2020 program of the European Union, and it aims to study brain injury in premature born infants, stem cell regeneration research network. This research network is really an international network of researchers and stakeholders, mainly from Europe, but also from Australia. And Fabiana joined us as a parent representative, so also Canada is involved. Let me first explain some terminology and basics of our project about encephalopathy of prematurity, and then about stem cells, and then talk about the project itself. If babies are born prematurely, their brain is obviously not mature yet. It's underdeveloped. And you can see here at 6 months of gestational age, which is sort of 26 weeks gestation, this is where babies are born or even earlier, you see that the brain is small, but also very smooth. It's not really completely developed yet as it should be or as it will be at term age, as you can see here. Much larger with a lot of indentations and a well-developed brain. Something can go wrong there. And if things go wrong, there might be long-term effects. And we know that long-term outcomes of very premature infants and especially the extremely premature infants can have these long-term effects. About 10% die in the first weeks following birth. About 10% have serious disabilities for the rest of their lives, like really low IQ, blindness, hearing problems, severe physical disabilities. 40% have some problems in these areas, but much less severe. And 40% grow up without problems. Obviously, this is sort of in general figures, but it's, of course, very dependent on gestational age and also on other many other factors. This is an MRI scan from a 24-weeker on the left side and a 40-week, so term age, on the right side. And you see, again, the same kind of differences. A very smooth brain on the left, not so much developed with the gyri and all the development that should take place, and also the white matter here that is really developed in the term brain. So there still should be a lot of development between, let's say, 24 weeks and term age going on. If this goes wrong again, I talked about this, but there can be developmental disabilities with cognitive impairment, deafness, blindness, cerebral palsy, but also later on attention deficit disorders, learning disabilities, and even psychiatric problems. We also know that the lower the gestational ages, the higher the chance of needing special education later on. This is a very preterm infant of 25 weeks, was 440 grams. You see here the baby, if you take the cap off, and here you see the ultrasound probe. This is a position where the ultrasonographer is taking an ultrasound for the baby, and I will show the ultrasound. This baby developed a severe abdominal disease, which we call necrotizing enterocolitis on day 12. And because of this instability, he developed severe brain damage, which are the white areas that you can see here. And we call this damage in the white matter of the brain, we call this periventricular leukomalacia, or PVL. In this case, many days later, you see that here developed some cysts, which really are signs of damaged brain. Schematically, you see this periventricular leukomalacia here in yellow on this map. But in general, this is at about 28 weeks of gestation when the baby is born. And in general, two big things should happen in brain development. One is that myelinization should take place. Myelin is the substance that makes the axons, so the interconnection between neurons, makes it conductible, so that stimulus can go from one neuronal cell to another. For example, from the cortex, stimuli can go via the spinal cord down to the muscles, and the baby or later the adult can move. If this myelinization is not taking place very well, because these oligodendrocytes that I will talk about later don't develop well, so if this is not taking well, then there is really a disturbance in this conductivity, and for example, motor problems might happen later, but also other problems. In addition, the brain, as I showed earlier, is still not really developed, and these neuronal cells come from this area deep in the brain. They migrate to the cortex of the brain, which is this gray area again. So this is the cortex, this is deeper areas in the brain, same here. And so these cells, this neuronal cell, should migrate to the cortex to make up the cortex later and then develop, as was shown on the MRI and the other pictures. But if there is damage here in this area, so in this area and here as well, then this development does not take place normally. Also, even without this severe injury, which is called this PVL, this development can be disturbed in premature infants and can lead to problems. These are these oligodendrocytes, so that are the cells, not the neurons itself, but cells that make this myelin and make this conductivity between neurons possible, so to give impulses from one cell to the other or from the brain to the muscles. And normally at 23 to 32 weeks, so in very premature infants, these oligodendrocytes are not mature yet, and they are not connected really yet. So you see these cells in a culture lying here. But if they mature over 32 weeks, you see all these connections which are formed by axons and myelin, so this connection between the neurons, which should normally happen. If this does not happen, these cells that make this myelin degenerate again or don't develop normally, and you don't see these connections. So this first stage is immature, like babies are born, but then it should develop into a mature stage over 32 weeks and further. But if this does not develop, you don't see these connections, and things go really wrong, and you might have several problems. So in general, this this encephalopathy of prematurity is made up both of injury, but also just disturbed maturation. It's not just damaging it, but it's also not the normal maturation that takes place, and it's a little bit interlinked. And of course, prematurity is a large part of the cause of that, and this encephalopathy of prematurity might then lead to long-term problems. There are two factors that are important, two main factors at least, that are important in modifying this prematurity leading to encephalopathy of prematurity. And that's inflammation, which even frequently happens before birth. Babies are born prematurely because of a reason, and chorea amnionitis and inflammation in utero already is a frequent cause of premature birth. And also after birth, inflammation can happen, for example, during sepsis, so blood infection or other infections and other inflammations that happen. And hypoxia can happen at birth, but also later when there are circulatory or ventilatory problems and other problems as well. So these three factors essentially together are the main factors that lead to this, let's say, disease or disturbed maturation of the brain. So what we want to look at in this project is whether stem cells can really inhibit or improve, at least, or diminish this encephalopathy of prematurity. So let's go to stem cells now. This is parental advice of one cell to another, and that's the essence of stem cells. You can be anything you want to be when you grow up. I'll explain this a little bit further. On this axis, you see the human developmental continuum. So it starts as a single cell embryo after fertilization. Then this cell starts dividing into more cells, and it becomes a developing embryo. Of course, these first cells, they can become eventually, after dividing and differentiation, they will become any organ, because from these cells, the liver has to be made, the brain has to be made, the gut has to be made, the lungs have to be made. So they can become any cell in the body later. And that's why they're called totipotent. They can become everything. So these are called embryonic stem cells. So to use these cells for treatment is also potentially ethically a problem, because in some countries this would not be allowed to use these for treatment or even to do research. So this really might, depending on country and culture, lead to ethical problems. But when the embryo develops further, still there are stem cells that regenerate and make up the tissue. And eventually, we come to the fetus, and when a fetus is born, you can take, here's the infant born, you can take stem cells from the cord, or from the cord blood, but also from the cord jelly, and also from the placenta. And these stem cells still can develop into many cells, but not all cells anymore. I will talk a little bit further about that. But obviously, there's much less of an ethical issue here, because these are stem cells that are a waste anyway, because they would go, the cord would go away otherwise. So there are many sorts of stem cells, but the essence of stem cells is always that they undergo self-renewal and that they differentiate into different kinds of cells. So they make up other cells. And the self-renewal is necessary because if you damage an organ, I'm not talking about big damage, but for example, you cut yourself in the skin, this has to be renewed, this has to be repaired. And the stem cells, they start dividing and then differentiate into the cells that are needed to cover the skin or the liver or whatever organ that's damaged. And so they make sure there is repair and self-renewal over time so that we don't get old even before we are before we are old age, let's say. So there's a continuous cell renewal, but also repair if there is damage. So also in culture, these stem cells can go division continuously, while other cells would always stop after a while. And then they can differentiate into other cells, such as anything, essentially. But that depends on the sort of stem cell. Embryonic cells can go to everything, but there are, this cartoon shows sort of three different kind of stem cells, depending on where you can find them. One is called the mesenchymal stem cell, which is, for example, in fat, in connective tissue of the skin, and things like that. You have neural stem cell niche, so in the brain, there is also stem cells that renew part of the neurons and are a sort of reserve capacity there. And this is an example of hematopoietic stem cell niche, so in the bone marrow, and that's a rapidly dividing stem cells because they need to make new blood all the time. Here we are talking about mesenchymal stem cells that we will use in this project, or that we are using in this project. And so they are derived, like I said, from the cord jelly. You could potentially, let me go back to that. You could potentially use the cord stem cells for their own baby. So you cut the cord, you culture the stem cells from the jelly of the cord, and then once you have cultured them after several days, you could potentially use the own baby's stem cell to give back. But that's very difficult to be proven and probably not necessary at all. That's called autologous stem cells. But it's much easier to collect cords from term babies and from a lot of babies and to culture them in good conditions and then pool them. And so then you have allogenic stem cells, so stem cell for somebody else, but it seems to work as well, and there is not rejection of these stem cells happening in when you use them as a therapy. So let's go to the basics of what these stem cells do. Well, there are actually two possibilities for stem cells to work. You would think stem cells, they divide and they would make up new tissue, which also sort of happens, but when we use it for this kind of therapy that we are talking about here, that's not what's happening. It's not a stem cell that goes to the brain, becomes brain cells, and starts dividing and making new brain. That's not what is happening here, or maybe to a very minimal extent. These stem cells go to the brain and to other tissues because they feel where the damage is and they're attracted to that, but they don't really stay there very long. We know that they disappear, and that's also nice for safety because they disappear anyway. They don't gonna make tumors or so. So we know that they in principle disappear. But in the meantime, they have effects. So they are attracted to where the damage is, for example, the brain or the lung or wherever, and they secrete factors, which is called paracrine effects. So these stem cells are attracted there. So they go there, they secrete many factors, growth factors, anti-inflammatory factors, many factors. And they, in the brain, for example, but it's also true for other organs, in the brain, they increase the neuronal survival. So cells don't die as easily, for example, after hypoxia, if they don't get enough oxygen, they would die otherwise easily. But they are sort of at least slightly protected by these stem cell products. Increased neurogenesis, so better development of the brain cells. Decreased inflammation. I told you that inflammation is a very important factor. And these secretory products of the stem cells clearly decrease inflammation in many tissues where there is damage, also in the brain. And mitochondrial activation. I told you that not enough oxygen, or hypoxia, we call that, is also a big factor in this brain development or damage. And of course, the mitochondria are the cell organs in the cell that provide the energy and need the oxygen to provide this energy. So that's also a very important mechanism. Overall, this leads to neuronal protection or neural protection and repair. So this is what we are striving for. And this is the mechanism that is known to happen. So in general, the current evidence for stem cells is that they are effective in many animal models of brain injury, for example, stroke. they are effective and safe for different diseases in human adults. So they are already used for therapy for different diseases, for example, stroke in adults at the moment. There are several studies that show that they work and are safe. And there are some phase one and phase two trials in human neonates and even in preterm neonates, for example, for bronchopulmonary dysplasia. And it seems, and also for intraventricular hemorrhage, and it seems like they are safe so far. And I wrote down probably effective because phase one and phase two trials are clinical trials with not many infants. They are really meant to study if it's safe and if there might be an effect. So it's not like big studies already, what we call phase three studies that really prove effectiveness. You also know this from the COVID pandemic now. And so you need very large phase three trials to prove that something is effective and safe on a large scale. So that's not where we are at. But overall, because of all this, it seems very promising. But many questions remain. And that's what we want to answer also in this project called PREMSTEM. So let's go to the project now. So the overall objective of the project, from stem cells to the infant and to adult life, is we aim to validate umbilical cord-derived human mesenchymal stem cells as a regenerative therapy for encephalopathy of prematurity to improve the quality of life for these infants and reduce the societal costs of their special needs. It's a preclinical study. That means it's not yet in infants that we study it. That's the plan after this project. But this is preclinical study, so mainly in animals, in preparation for clinical trials as a next step. And what are our questions and how do we do this? We have animal models of prematurity, of inflammation, and of hypoxia, so not enough oxygen, in different animals, such as rats and sheep. And we use these models to study what is the optimal route of administration. So essentially, we study two routes. One is the intravenous, so you give the stem cells intravenously, and they move through the blood to the site of injury, as we know from other models and other testing. But we also want to know which dose of cells should we give, what is the timing directly after birth, or can we wait a little bit, or if a sepsis happens, do we have to give it then, or what exactly do we have to do? Or should we give it even before birth, but that's going to be difficult. And the route of administration can be intravenous, like I said, but also intranasally, because we know it moves to the brain from the nasal route as well, at least in rats. So we want to test if it's also happening, for example, in sheep, and then potentially in human infants later. Do these optimized treatment models also provide long-term functional and structural neuroregeneration, or at least protection against problems? How do these human mesenchymal stem cells perform, and can this performance be improved? And do these optimized treatment models also provide long-term functional, cellular, molecular, structural, that's all what we are studying in these models, neuroregeneration, in additional small animal models? So we are setting up more models to see from different angles of inflammation, hypoxia, and prematurity, to see if it works in all the models. Because if it works in small animal models and in large animal models with different injuries that we impose on them, like inflammation or hypoxia, the more likely is it also going to work in human infants. And also how better we can understand this brain injury in infants. Besides animal models, we also use cultures, cell cultures. And you see here inserts into cell culture discs. In the bottom are, in this case, you can also do neurons and other cells. But as I talked about oligodendrocytes that makes this myelin, I choose for a slide with the oligodendrocyte precursors. So they are on the bottom. There's no contact between this and this, no direct contact. There is a filter in between, but the fluid can go through. And then you put these mesenchymal stem cells on top. And of course, they secrete these factors, as I told you, this pyrokine effect. And they will have an effect on these oligodendrocytes. And then we will measure under different conditions like hypoxia, hypoxia, inflammation, and so on, how they proliferate, how they survive, how they differentiate and mature, because that's what we want to study, how they look like essentially, and then with, of course, very sophisticated techniques. This is also actually a sort of additional thing that we are studying in one of the work packages of this PremStem project, which is very nice. It's not directly related to the stem cells, but it might help us in the future to personalize therapy. And the question is, can we use our robust preclinical models, so the animal models mainly, of this encephalopathy of prematurity to develop and validate a novel imaging platform that will enable stratification of preterm infants to receive the most appropriate, or call it personalized therapy? So can we use imaging, a sort of ultrasound system? It's based on ultrafast ultrasound, so it's similar to having an ultrasound on the head of the baby, but now with a very sophisticated system where you can see more. And you can see here from the red, this is the normal ultrasound with Doppler, and this is this ultrafast enhanced, I would say, imaging, where you can see already better the structure. This is even a human infant, and the normal Doppler, so where you see blood flow Doppler, and ultrasound on the head of the baby, but this is with this improved one, and you see that the structure you can see much better, and here with this technique you can even see the vessels much better. So we hope we can study the baby by not always using MRIs, and so that you can maybe only do once, but at the bedside, and we will test this system in these animal studies as well, and see if the stem cells have effect on these pictures, so that we can early see if there is a differences in brain development or not. Finally, we also want to look at the patient's perspective. Of course, we include patients, consumers, for their viewpoint at all stages of our research to ensure a smooth acceptance to the clinical trials. Because when we are done with this project, we want to go as quickly as possible to clinical trials because we think it's really promising. And therefore, we set up a patient consumer advisory board where also Fabiana is in. This is the neonatal healthcare ecosystem, so the premature infants and their caregivers and family and friends, the provider, hospital, clinicians, nurses in the close circle, and then further like teachers, social workers, researchers, and entrepreneurs. So we will involve stakeholders to discuss how we go further. And EFCNI, that's the organization I work for, European Foundation for the Care for Newborn Infants in Europe, our role is to lead one work package to increase the visibility and impact of PremStem on health and society by developing a dissemination exploitation strategy. So the first objective is to really increase this visibility and impact. We want to identify the most effective ways to generate a regulatory approval to ensure that we can move into clinical trials as soon as possible after this project is finished, when we solve our questions, and the specific involvement of patient-consumer representatives in order to give input and feedback to all information on the project. And we want to ensure the most appropriate use of the project findings as an exploitation strategy will be developed starting from the beginning of the project towards its duration, also with the aim of going as fast as possible to clinical use after the project is finished. In this work package, we also do co-creation. Co-creation means we put all the stakeholders together and we think about the future, what would happen in the future and how we develop this project. And why is co-creation so important? Because you have the viewpoint of the different stakeholders, like here is the elephant, and the different blind people that are feeling the elephant have all a different viewpoint. It's a rope, it's a spear, it's a snake. And if you put it all together, you come to the solution. So to summarize, every year in the world, 15 million infants are born preterm. Neurodevelopmental disabilities occur in more than 50% of the at least the extremely preterm born infants, if you take the mild forms into account as well. In PremStem, we want to develop the knowledge on the most neurotherapeutic mesenchymal cell strategy for this encephalopathy of prematurity caused by different types of injuries that I talked about, common in preterm born infants. We have this innovative imaging modality that we also study for patient stratification and personalization. We have the patient consumer consultation, and which will hopefully lead to exploitation of the findings to improve the health outcomes eventually. After the PremStem project, we want to start clinical trials on the efficacy, safety, and mechanism of action of these stem cells, and of course, use these imaging modalities as well, leading hopefully to improved outcomes for babies, families, and global community. So I think this is a good example of translational research from bedside where the question arises to bench and back with animal studies, back to the infants, and leading from laboratory research up to public health issue that hopefully can be ameliorated. These are our junior researchers that made nice pictures for World Prematurity Day 10 days ago. And this is one of our video calls, and I just want to point out one person here. That's Pierre Gassin. He is the main investigator of the project. He's always a little bit in the back. He's very shy. You have to really look for pictures where he is on. But here I have one, so I want to mention him and thank him for leading this project. And let's go to the last slide. You can follow PremStem on social media and our website. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for your presentation. This is a very exciting project, and I'm very grateful that I am actually involved in this project in a little small, in a small way to collaborate as a parent advisor. I'm very happy and excited about this. We had a comment here from, I believe, a parent. She said, my 400 gram 24 weeker was able to do a 45 seconds of delayed cord clamping. And I guess this was also my question when I first came across this project. How is that different from delayed cord clamp where the baby is still receives some stem cells from the blood cord?
Well, we know that delayed cord clamping is very helpful. So in principle, it should be done whenever possible. And but the effect of the stem cells itself is rather small. There are for sure stem cells in the cord blood, and probably that might explain a bit of the effect. But probably the main effect of delayed cord clamping is more the blood volume, the red blood cell mass that you give extra to the baby, and not so much the stem cells, although of course you give a little bit more stem cells. Because when you collect the cord or cord blood, you would concentrate the and grow the stem cells in culture further, so you have a much higher amount of stem cells. But that's actually also part of this project, what you want to look at. How many stem cells, how much do you need to have a good effect, and not too much, because we know if you give too much intravenously, for example, they start cluttering together, and you get complications of just the amount of cells that you give in the bloodstream. But okay, that's of course something we should avoid. Exactly the amount of stem cells that we need, that's part of the project. But it seems like just delayed cord clamping is not enough to have this effect good enough.
Absolutely. But it is becoming a standard of care, at least here in Canada, but it's fascinating to see what else we're going to be doing in the future. So in terms, you mentioned a little bit about how you're going to be studying if the infusion has to be before birth, if the mom is the verge of delivering early or right after birth. Are we going to have some diagnostic imaging before you actually implement or make the infusion with the stem cells? Or is going to be later on when you already see there was a damage, or it's going to be some more prophylaxis? What is the study tending to go?
Yeah, that's a very good question, but we actually don't know completely yet. So that's two questions. What is the indication, which group to target exactly, and then also the timing. there's a phase one study that was done in Korea for intraventricular hemorrhage, but then you know already there is something wrong, something happened, and then you give stem cells. They give it directly by puncture, by the way. But we hope that we will have, let's say, a risk factor certification, and that this new imaging ultrasound technique might be very helpful in determining that. And even if we cannot determine the risk factors by using this ultrasound, it would for sure be a useful tool to continuously follow the infant, which is now sort of not possible. We have, of course, we follow with ultrasound, but the resolution is not as good as the MRI by far, and you cannot do continuous MRIs on a baby. So, I think probably when clinical trials start, they probably will start with the highest risk groups, which might be babies, for example, that have chorioamnionitis or have growth retardation, or just the smallest premature infants under, let's say, 25 weeks or so, or the ones, if we start a little bit later, the ones that already start having some potential problems, like echogenicity of the brain, where you think, yes, some of this preventricular leukomalacia must start happening, and then give it only. But that's not decided yet. That's actually also part of why we do this, these studies, to really understand what would be best. Yeah, and also when it's effective, of course.
So I think my next question is, we're going to into clinical trials. We have a timeline for that. And you see, okay, this is successful. We should start this in as many hospitals as possible. And we know how much time it takes between clinical trials to become mainstream and implemented in an ICUs around the world. So how are you planning to disseminate this knowledge once the clinical trials is over, to see if you can speed up the process so we can support generations faster than, you know, here in Canada, we know there is 17 years between the research to implementation. So how are we going to speed that up?
Well, obviously, within the neonatal world, we have a very good group of researchers. So we like scientifically to publish this work, to spread it in the conferences. And hopefully, if it, the better it works, the easier it's going to be, of course. If it's some door that works a bit, then, of course, not, it's not so easily going to be taken up. But we don't have much treatment for premature infants' brain damage, essentially, at the moment. So, and this seems to work, at least so far, like I told you. And so it's very promising. So I think this might help a lot to spread the news easier. And obviously with parent organizations and EFCNI, that's one thing that's why we are involved in these kind of projects, of course. And also you see with the COVID what happens. I mean, if there's enough pressure and time, resources and priority, then it can go very fast with the vaccination. So they're almost already there. So it's possible to speed it up and not to have it to wait 17 years. And actually, this is also the main reason why we are preparing this, let's say, co-creation sessions, thinking about the future, how to set up the clinical trials, this exploitation plan. This is really to have it improved or approved, I must say, as fast as possible after this preclinical trials to go to really clinical trials. And obviously, it also helps that some phase one trials are done with stem cells and it's already used in adults, which might also help to speed up things. Because if you really develop something that's only there for premature infants, then it's going to be very difficult to go fast. But because these cells are also used for other purposes, it might go easier.
Absolutely. Dr. Zimmerman, thank you so much for joining us here today. We have your website up, so if people are interested in learning more about it, and the face of the study is on premstem.eu. Dr. Zimmerman, thank you so much for joining us here today. I'm looking forward to the results of this study in a few years to come and continue to work with you in this project.
Yeah, thank you so much. Also, look forward to the results and also to work with you further. Thank you. Thank you for joining us also in the advisory board.
Thank you. And for all of you watching us here today, either on Facebook or on YouTube, thank you for joining us and for interacting. Please send your suggestions, what else you want to see us addressing here. And the video of today's session and all the videos from our Facebook Live series are available on the CPBF website, which is CanadianPremies.org. And we are a charitable organization, and we believe that through education and support, we can empower families, ensuring they are ready to care for their premature babies. Please visit our website, consider making a donation. Together, we can create a brighter future for all families. And see you again next Friday, 1 p.m.